Hello friends and welcome to Digimento. Today we'll be discussing a very important current affair, very important topic, that is new education policy of 2020. Now, why this is a very important topic? First of all, the reason is that this is a very big structural reform introduced by the government after so many years. There was a demand for bringing in structural reforms in the education sector for very long. But now the government has introduced that, and therefore it's very, very important. And if all these recommendations are implemented properly, then definitely this is going to bring up huge reformation in the education sector, which was a long standing demand from the public. So we will see that in detail. We will discuss about the important provisions of new education policy 2020 in detail in this lecture. And before that, this is our channel Digimento, and you can subscribe to our channel for getting more updates about the videos that we upload, and also press the bell icon for getting the updates. And also, if you are preparing for GATE, NTA, UGC, NET or PGT Computer Science, we are providing online coaching for the same. You can visit our website www.digimento.com, or you can call to this number for getting more information about the online courses that we provide. So let's start. Now, let's first see what is the most important or the major highlight of this education policy, the new education policy of 2020. So first of all, the most important highlight, the most important change that has been made is to the curricular structure. So curricular structure here means that earlier we had a 10 plus 2 structure. So I'll explain it to you. Okay, earlier we had a 10 plus 2 structure, which means that the academics was in the form of 10th standard plus 2 years of senior secondary. So this was the earlier criteria. Now it has been restructured as 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4, covering the ages between 3 to 18 years. So I'll explain it to you how. So earlier there was a 10 plus 2 format, but this has been removed now. Now instead of that, we have 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4. I'll explain what it is. So here the 5 years, that is the initial 5 years. So this initial 5 years, it refers to the age group of 3 to 8 years. That is from the play school to the class 2. So this is the first 5. So this is what is meant by the first 5. Then we have 3 years. That 3 years combined together, this is from class 3 to 5. Okay. Then we have another 3 years, which is equal to class 6 to 8. 6, 7 and 8. Then the last 4 years. So this refers to class 9 to 12. So this will be the categorization. So this is the most important change that has been made, and within that the most important one is the first 5 years. We will see that in detail. Now, early childhood care and education. So early childhood care, that means education given in the early stages, that is from 3 years to 8 years, that is the initial 5 years. So, the government has considered this as the foundation of learning. So, initial 5 years will be the foundation of learning. And in this 5 years, the government is planning to provide ECCE. This is important. ECCE. We will see what is ECCE in detail. ECCE is Early Childhood Care and Education. So, here ECCE means, early childhood education. So, how it will be? It will be involving art, stories, poetry, games, songs and things like that. And also, it will be incorporated suitably. 6 months training for ECCE qualification will be provided to the teachers. So, those teachers who are handling these children within the age group of 3 to 8 years, they will be given a 6 months training if they have completed the 10 plus 2 and if they are currently working as Anganwadi teachers. Otherwise, those who have lesser qualification, instead of 6 months, 1 year training will be given. Which means that those teachers who want to teach these children between the age group of 3 to 8 years, they will be given more training. Now, here comes the nodal agencies for the implementation of early childhood care and education. It is MHRD, Ministry of Human Resource Development, Women and Child Development, health and family welfare and tribal affairs. So these are the nodal agencies for the implementation of this scheme. Now, what are the different types of skills that will be imparted during this early stages of education, that is between 3 to 8 years? So physical and motor skills. Motor skills examples are like, for example, doing puzzles, solving puzzles, etc. Then socio emotional and ethical skills, communication and early language skills, cognitive skills, cultural and artistic skills, and numeracy and literacy skills. So these are the skills. Now we will come to the institutions which will provide early childhood education. So those institutions which provide the early childhood education, one is stand-alone Anganwadis. What is meant by stand-alone Anganwadis? Stand-alone Anganwadis means that those Anganwadis which are detached or which are independent from that of primary schools. Second one is Anganwadis that are located with primary schools. That means those Anganwadis which will come within the premises of the primary schools. Then the third category is the pre-primary. Pre-primary means from classes maybe first standard onwards or kindergarten onwards, 5 to 6. Then stand-alone preschools. So these are the four categories of institutions which will provide the ECCE or the early childhood care and education. Okay. Now this is regarding foundational literacy and numeracy skills to be provided in the ECCE. So here some important points are that states or the union territory governments, they will be preparing the implementation plan and to make it universal, that is the early childhood care and education will be made universal or made available to everyone, and this will be achieved by the year 2025. Then teachers training, high quality resources, nutrition. That is why the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare is involved. So this will provide nutrition. So, okay. Then interim 3 month play based school. Now what is meant by this interim 3 month? That is before entering class one, that is after your play school or your kindergarten, before entering the class one, 3 months of interim period. So during this interim period, play based modules will be given to the children to equip them to join the formal education system. Then the public and school libraries will be significantly expanded and digital libraries will also be established. Now this is regarding curtailing the dropout rates and ensuring universal access. Dropout means children, those who leave the school without completing the education. So in order to curtail or to bring down the dropout rates, that is to eliminate or to bring down the number of cases where the children leave the school before completing their schooling, what the government will do, infrastructural support will be given. So for achieving this universal participation, tracking of students as well as tracking the learning levels will be done. Social workers or counselors will be appointed to deal with the psychological issues of the students. Then NIOS, which is a National Institute of Open Schooling, and state open schools will offer A, B, C levels that are equivalent to 3, 5 and 8 of the formal school system. Then community participation will also be ensured. Now, this is what we discussed in the beginning. I think there is no need to discuss it in detail again. Now, the new structure has been introduced where instead of 10 plus 2, what we will be adopting now will be a 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4 design. So, here the foundational stages will be from 5 years to, 3 years to 8 years. So, 3 to 8 years. Okay, preparatory stages. That is from class 3 to 5. So here introduction to experiential learning will be given. Then next is the middle school, middle stage and the secondary stage. So we have already explained that. Now these are the details of experiential learning and also the holistic development of the learners. So I'm not going into all the details. The PPT will be made available for you. Now, another very important point here is that there will be no hard separation or there will be no watertight separation with regard to curricular, co-curricular and extracurricular activities. So, all will be equally important. So, there will be no hard separation among the curricular, extracurricular or co-curricular activities. That means equal importance will be given to extracurricular activities as well. Okay. Then reduction in curriculum content. So content, that is the syllabus of the classes, will be reduced so that there will be more space for including all these extracurricular and co-curricular activities. So curriculum content will be reduced, and this will provide more space for critical thinking, holistic and inquiry based learning, which will include all the extracurricular and co-curricular activities. Okay. So content will be reduced. This is another important point, and teachers will be teaching in an interactive manner. Now, multilingualism. What is meant by multilingualism? The use of more than one language. So how this will be incorporated? That means local language will also be incorporated in the schools, and teaching will be done, or instruction will be given in local language, at least minimum till class 5, and then preferably till class 8, the students will be given the instructions in home language or mother tongue itself. So this is to promote the multilingualism, and also to make at the early stages of studies or education, to make it more clear for the students. Then certain subjects like skills, capacities, etc. will be emphasized. So these are some areas where more emphasis will be given, apart from just learning. Now what we have to understand here is that till now the focus of all the schools or the education system in whole is to provide some kind of, you know, knowledge, or like the bookish knowledge to the students. Now the focus has been shifted from merely providing bookish knowledge to development, overall or holistic development of the student. So scientific temper and evidence-based thinking, creativity, innovativeness, sense of aesthetics, oral and written communication, health and nutrition, physical education, collaboration and teamwork, problem solving and logical reasoning, digital literacy, ethical and moral reasoning. So these are certain subjects that will be given more emphasis. Next is regarding national textbooks with local content and flavor, which means that the national textbooks, the textbooks that we learn in the schools, apart from containing those national issues or national subjects, local subjects and local content will also be incorporated in the textbooks. So essential core material on national level will be definitely there, but at the same time the textbooks will also have some of the local content. Okay, what does it mean? For example, let us take the state of Maharashtra. Okay, definitely there will be certain, let's take the subject history. Okay, definitely the national movement or whatever is important from the national level, it will be included. But apart from that, the state's history will also be included. Like that, the local content will be incorporated. Now, very important is that a focus will be given on imparting content or creating content to increase the knowledge about our country within the student community. So, knowledge of India, knowledge about our country will be included in the curriculum. So, this will include historical knowledge about the country, the scientific knowledge, the knowledge about tribes, indigenous communities, ethno-medical practices. So, ancient India, modern India, then science. So all these will be imparted, like human rights, basic human rights, constitutional values, etc. So knowledge about our country will also be imparted through this textbooks. Now next is transforming assessment for student development. Now here a very important thing is that this assessment here refers to the progress reports or the assessment of progress of the students. Now very important point is that earlier, or we can say in the present system, the teacher alone makes the evaluation. Now the evaluation will be threefold. One evaluation will be made by the teacher, one by the peer group, and third by the student himself or herself, that is self-assessment. So the progress card will be holistic and multidimensional, which will include self-assessment, peer assessment and teacher assessment. Okay. Now support will be given for gifted students. Gifted means those students with certain special talents. So those students will be given more support. So the NCERT and the NCTE will develop the guidelines for the same. And also the BEd programs will allow a specialization in education of gifted children. Okay, so extracurricular activities will be promoted, and those children who have some special talents in all these will be promoted. The next is regarding teacher recruitment and deployment. So here very important is that the transfer of teachers will be conducted through an online platform or online computerized system, and this will ensure transparency. And the TETs, tests, that is a teacher eligibility test, it will be strengthened and extended to cover pre-primary to grade 12 teachers in both public and private schools. Okay. Again, special educators, that is those teachers who teach the Divyang children or children with certain disabilities or differently abled children. So for that, for subject teaching, for children with disabilities and Divyang children at the middle and secondary school level, specializations will be offered during or after pre-service. Next is continuous professional development, which means that even after becoming a teacher, or suppose a person gets employed as a teacher, even after that on the job training will be done. Every year at least 50 hours of training will be done by the teachers, and it is mandatory. Minimum 50 hours of CPD or the continuous professional development training should be done by the teachers. And this is same with the school principals as well. They also are expected to participate in minimum 50 hours of CPD modules per year. And the principals, for principals, the focus will be on developing leadership, management, etc. Okay. And this is regarding the professional standards for the teachers. Common guiding set of NPST will be developed by 2022. So standards will be developed. This will improve the teaching quality. Now next one is there will be an integrated B.Ed. course which will be introduced by 2030. So integrated B.Ed. means a 4-year integrated B.Ed. degree will be given, and the universities and colleges, institutions will be allowed to start these courses. So they will be moved into multidisciplinary colleges and universities as well. And those who are already possessing a bachelor's degree, they can do a 2-year B.Ed. program. But from 2030, an integrated B.Ed. program or a B.Ed. degree will be introduced. Now, the teacher education, the regulatory system shall be empowered to take stringent action against substandard and dysfunctional teacher education institutions. So those teacher education institutions which are providing substandard or dysfunctional teacher education, stringent action will be taken. So all these are done in order to ensure the quality of teaching, thereby improve the learning outcomes. Next is equitable and inclusive education, that is learning for all or access of education for everyone. So here some certain areas will be focused upon. So they are gender identities, that is equitable or equal opportunities for different genders, particularly the female and transgenders, socio-cultural identities, geographical identities, disabilities, socio-economic conditions. Based on all these categories, special focus will be given on all these. Okay. Next is regarding the development of school complexes or clusters. This means that in a particular locality, more number of schools, that is more than one number of school, they can come together to form cluster, and the benefit or the advantage is that they can share the resources. So the benefits are that the resources can be shared. Now regarding accreditation for school education, independent responsibilities within the state education system will be given, and here within the state education system itself, the Department of School Education or DSE will be responsible for monitoring and policy making for continual improvement. Again, the Directorate of School Education will be responsible for educational operations and service provision for public schools. There will also be a effective quality self-regulation or accreditation system. Okay, this is all for accreditation. And the SCRTs, that is a State Council for Education Research and Training, will develop school quality assessment and accreditation framework through wide consultation, which means all the stakeholders who are included, they will be consulted, which means it is a participative approach. A participative approach will be taken. So one point is that participative approach. Second one is community participation or the role of community. Third is clusters, educational clusters, etc. Okay. Now, this is regarding the vocational education. By 2025, at least 50% of the learners through the school and higher education system will have exposure to vocational education. So, with increased access to vocational education, the skills imparted will increase and therefore the employability of the children will increase. Okay. So, vocational training will be given in crafts, carpentry, electric work, metal work, gardening, pottery making, etc. Next is regarding lifelong learning. Lifelong learning means learning by the adult. So, adult population, they can continue their learning for lifelong. So, adult education curriculum framework, it will be developed by a new constituent body of the NCERT that is dedicated to adult education. So, the curriculum framework for adult education, it includes 5 types of programs: foundational literacy, numeracy, critical life skills, vocational skills and basic education. So, this is regarding lifelong training. So, here you must understand that a focus has been given on lifelong education as well. And for maximizing the opportunities of lifelong education or lifelong learning, the schools and the school complexes after the school hours will be made use. The public libraries will be made use. So, this is how the infrastructure can be mobilized for lifelong learning. And trained instructors and educators will be required. And also qualified community members, like those who have retired from schools or colleges. So, all these retired community members can also become a part of this lifelong learning. So, these are the important provisions of the new education policy 2020, and understand that this is a huge structural reformation, a reformative step taken by the government of India after a very long time, very important from any examination perspective. And this is all. Thank you so much for watching this video, and if you have liked this video, please do share it with your friends. And as I said in the beginning, we are providing online courses for these examinations. For more details, you can visit our website or you can call to any of these numbers. Thank you.